say hello to all of those who may be looking through that little mini screen over there, and especially you in the pajamas. I'm glad you're here. That's all we care about. So, God bless. God bless. We have a number of announcements. Especially, you'll see an insert in the bulletin, the Lilies for Easter form. So that's coming up. Please make sure you sign that. You'll notice they're looking for all these orders to come in by April 3rd. So you have a week or two. Feel free to make sure you get those in early so that we know how many to order. Other announcements today. Are there other announcements? Yes. Budget committee meeting right after church. All right. And you said short, okay?
I don't know what short is.
I would like to reiterate or emphasize the coming of the North Carolina Baroque Orchestra is going to be here on April the 1st. It's going to be a wonderful concert, and we want to absolutely fill the church. The sign might be a little bit deceptive. It says donations only. Donations will be accepted, but we're not going to turn anybody away. And we want to have you here. But if you have an opportunity to be here, be sure you are and bring your neighbors and friends with you, because this is a wonderful concert. And frankly, the North Carolina Baroque Orchestra, and some of the people are good pals of mine, they enjoy playing here. This is one of the places that they go out of their way to make sure it's on their program schedule, because they enjoy, they have a time down at Camp Caroline, they enjoy these wonderful acoustics here. So the North Carolina Baroque Orchestra on April the 1st, which I believe is a Friday evening. So do not miss that.
Also take note of what you see being projected up on the walls, but especially today, the CWF meeting at 5 o'clock. So you'll all be meeting today. Are there any other announcements? If not, let's go to our call to worship, number 49. Let's stand and sing.
Father,
I need to do this because I'm all nervous and tight right now because it's my first time with you guys in this new situation. And as I was saying earlier, although I've been in a number of churches, this is like a totally new relationship. So I'm hoping we go to the movie you like, we go to the dinner you like. I hope I take you home nicely and all that because I'm a little nervous about this first date this morning. So prayers for this service. But just heard as I was coming in, Pat Steele had a kitchen fire. And it unfortunately was bad enough that it's not livable in that home anymore. So please keep her in your prayers. She has had a number of hits in her life, you might say. So please keep her in your prayers this morning. Also, you'll see the list that is in the bulletin of those we need to keep in prayer. Especially, I learned that Ronnie Avery has passed away and is now meeting our Lord, and to keep that family in prayer as well. Yes. Like this in their church, what it tells me is that this church believes in the power of prayer. And so let's go to prayer. Lord, there's so many people on this list. I give you thanks and praise that this congregation has a heart that is both deep and wide to cover all of those names, even the names that we don't recognize right away. We know you do. You know their situation better than we. And we give you thanks that we come to a place where praying for all of these folks is what's primarily important. We don't need to know everything about them, but we do know enough about you to know that you know their deepest desires, their wishes, their fears, and their dreams. And we pray that your arms will encircle them, your hands will lift them up, your voice will bring them peace. Lord, we especially pray for all those who are gathered here today, either here in these pews or with us in other ways. We pray that as they come together to worship, that they will hear what they need to hear, what the Lord would have them hear this day. And Lord, we also ask that you be with this church as it continues to be a good and faithful servant in this community, knowing that sometimes you hit a bump in the road, but ultimately, you're holding our maps, and we know that we are all heaven bound. And so, Lord, continue to be with us, guide us, and nurture us in our faith, grow us in our service. And we ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our hymn of prayer is number 537.
Proper beginning for our special music this morning. The singers are coming ahead. Hugh Livingston is a composer who has written many wonderful Christian pieces of music, and he has worked for many years for the Lorenz Corporation, who certainly make a lot of Christian music. And this is one of the songs that he wrote. It has an absolutely lovely melody and beautiful harmony. Jesus Savior.
Jesus, Savior.
reading today is from Psalm 63. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, my body longs for you, in a dry land and weary land where there is no water. I've seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory, because your love is better than life. My lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips my mouth will praise you. On my bed I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. May God add God's blessing to the reading of these words.
Thanks be to God.
In 1670, a book was published, written by Blaise Pascal. He wrote about the cravings we humans often feel and located these cravings within each of us. He called it an infinite abyss that keeps us looking for an infinite something to fill this hole within us. He writes that this infinite abyss can only be filled, quote, with an infinite and immutable object. In other words, by God himself, end quote. If you want the Twitter version, we are all born with a God-shaped hole deep within us. And it isn't just a passive hole within us, like a coffee mug that may or may not be filled at some times. This hole is actually a vacuum that drives us to fill it so that we can feel whole in our lives. I mean, you've seen this in children. When they desperately need a particular toy because their life will never be good again unless they have it. And maybe you decided, okay, you've heard it six times, maybe it's okay. There you are. 2 days later, you find that toy stuck underneath the bed somewhere, and there's this other toy that they really need because their friends have it too. But let's not just look at the children. Isn't it true that sometimes we as adults think that if we get that particular job or have that particular relationship, that somehow everything is just going to be just fine? Adults, unfortunately, we find that sometimes jobs and relationships that are given such a godlike status will come. Some folks write that this God-shaped hole is not biblical. But I beg to differ. Let me read again that first verse. O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you, my soul thirsts for you, my body longs for you, in a dry and weary land where there is no water. You see, the desire for the experience of God, it lives in any number of biblical images throughout the sacred text. We hunger and we thirst for the presence of God. And humanity is no different than today. We are no different today. We also read time and again in Scripture that placing anything in that hole other than God is idolatry. Now, back during the biblical days, a person had a buffet of gods and goddesses to choose from, or chosen for them by whomever happened to be in power at the time. And we know how God feels about idolatry, how Christ railed against options today in that shopping mall of false gods, and many of them don't even pretend to be spiritually based. In the West in which we live, it seems that both wealth and power seem to be the dominant false gods that many place within that God-shaped hole. Enough money or enough power to influence my life and people around me, and all will be well. Again, this is not new to you. Who did Jesus call out most often? But because these two are so pervasive, it's sometimes hard to know whether these false gods are trying to fill that space that is supposed to be created and dedicated to God. And they pretty much aren't the only ones. I mean, any human experience can be turned into a false god. Consumed by anger or resentment, consumed by fear of the world around us. Do I even need to mention politics? When we start seeing each other as less than human and less than a shared childhood of God, we have somehow placed a little false godling in that hole that wants to push out the one true God. And what's worse, we can't see it often. We miss the beauty around us because those false gods are very narrow. I'll give you an example. There is a friend of mine who decided to take me down to this favorite creek, and it was absolutely beautiful. I mean, the trees are beautiful. It was one of those kind of unspoiled mountain creek kind of things, and you know, you just feel like if I could just bring a chair and just sit down, and this would be the place. So I decided I'd go out and I'd walk in the creek a little bit, and when I came back out of that water, I had 5 leeches on me. And so my friends and I went about taking those leeches off. You know, just because of that, when I looked back at that creek and the beautiful forest around me, it became the enemy. Mm-hmm. I couldn't see the beauty that God had created there because for me, I only saw a place where leeches live now. I could not see the whole picture anymore. Okay. You may be expecting now, because that seems like I'm working up to it, some kind of hellfire and brimstone next. Here he comes. Sorry to disappoint. I'm not going there. Instead of spending my time, I'm still up here looking down and trying to pick at all the darknesses that human beings have to offer this world, unfortunately. I think I'd rather look above those shadows and above those clouds and see the bright light that the Lord Jesus Christ has given us and shown us during his time on earth and in his resurrection that we will celebrate not too many weeks away. I mean, truly, our mistakes are never a done deal with God. Do you know people who have made some mistake in their life and somehow that mistake has become the false god that closes them off from being loved and sharing love? That one mistake that God probably forgot eons ago. You know, if it wasn't so, I don't think humanity would even be here anymore. If all you had to do was make one mistake and God said, "That's it, I'm starting again." Christ has told us that these false gods are like parasites with no deep roots within us, and they have no concern about the welfare of their host and whom they seek to attach their hooks. But thank God we have the season of Lent. It's a curious line. Most people think, Lent, you know, can't we just skip and go to Advent? the season of Lent, because now it's time to check those inner landscapes, to find out, are there any signs of little hooks where false gods have begun to reside? And with the knowledge that the grace of God, and often with the help of Christian neighbors, remove them. Now, I need to tell you that sometimes during Lent, there have been conversations I've had where someone has seen and done that interior work and seen a bunch of sins and things that they would like to get rid of. And what they really want to do in their heart of hearts is to get all of them together, some of them that have been there 20, 30, 40 years, put them in a pail and get them out of there and somehow hope that that's what's exactly going to happen. But as you know, if you're about ready to do that kind of work, sometimes it takes friends and it takes one, two, three. It's a gentle, compassionate approach rather than a ripping. And so with the grace of God and the help of Christian friends, we can remove these things that keep us following these false gods. So when we hunger, let's not turn to the fast food of the false gods. When we thirst, let's not turn to the salt water Paul poured out by these false gods. When we faint for the presence of God, let's not grab on to the flimsiest of props, which are all that false gods can truly offer. As we respond to the opportunities of Lent, the opportunities of Lent to free our hearts, to free our souls, to sweep off the dust and make that holy seat within us ready, let us place in our hearts, in that process, or maybe even beside our beds at night and see it in the morning, these words: O God, you are my God, and earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, and my body longs for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary, and I beheld your power and your glory, because your love is better than life. My lips will glorify you. As your love. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches. Write this down, but I see the phrase watches of the night, and the Spirit tells me I need to share this with you. I'm not sure if you're like me, but I know if there's something that is in me that's trying to take me away from God or I feel bad about it, it's always that like 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning moment. I kind of call them my demon moments. The ones when I am tired and I'm exhausted, and for some reason, man, those things just love a vacuum. They are ready to come in. But with this at my bedside, on my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night, because you are my help. And I love this image. I sing in the shadow of your wings, which, by the way, the shadow of your wings must be. My soul clings to you, and your right hand upholds me. May it be so, and may God bless us all. Amen. Our hymn of invitation is Just As I Am Without One Plea, number 339. And as it is the time to come down front. That's what we do here. Yes. Yes. All right. Let's all stand and sing. Sometimes as we sit in the comfort of the homes in which we live, whether they be luxurious or meager in the eyes of the world, we know that we can be no richer than to be in your home, in your house, in the house of God. And Lord, we are reminded, as we may be watching TV and seeing what's happening in the Ukraine, see people totally devastated, their homes are gone. Even if by some chance they were able to come back to their homes tomorrow, there would be nothing to come back to. Help us to remember to give you thanks and praise whenever we walk into our kitchens and have that terrible duty of trying to decide just which thing we're going to fix. Lord, help us to recognize also that this church is a body. It is part of the body of Christ, and it needs to be strong. It needs to be healthy. It needs to be united. gifts that we bring, whether they be treasures or time or talents. We'll continue to strengthen the shared faith and unity of service that this church has been known for. And we ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I need to tell you that when I was in seminary, it was a Presbyterian seminary, I went to my advisor. I was about ready to graduate, and as a Presbyterian at that time, you only did communion about once a quarter. That was their tradition. I know it's been changed somewhat, but that was our tradition back then. And I said to my advisor, I've really got a problem because I am so communion focused in my own spirituality, my own understanding of Christ, that waiting every quarter to do that is, I would have a difficult time doing that. And my advisor said, well, in that case, you can either go to this one group, I won't mention the name of the group, but she said, if you suddenly showed up at the front of their church and said, I'm here, I'd like to be your pastor, they would very quickly usher you out. And then she said, but you might want to look into the Disciples of Christ. They have communion every Sunday. And it was at that point, even before I started the process, I knew I had found a spiritual home. In a place that knows that no matter how beautiful the sermon might be, with apologies to the beautiful music you have here, this is really what it all comes down to. This is the foundation of the sermon, the foundation of sacred music, the foundation of service. This is where we get our life and our breath to be together and to serve. And in that knowledge, we invite all those who profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior to please join us. And I need to say this to folks that may be home. If it's Oreo cookies and orange juice, take a moment in prayer, and it will also become the sacred meal of communion today. So I invite you in Sundays that are coming up to maybe gather some of those elements together so that you can join us in one of the most, to me, the most sacred moment in any worship service. Our hymn of communion, Bread of the World in Mercy Broken, number 387, verse 1.
that although the painting is of the disciples, we don't see the chairs on this side of the table. And the reason why we don't see the chairs is because they are set for us. So I invite you now to imagine that there is a chair set for you at that holiest of holy tables. If you need to dust it off a little bit, spend some time doing that. And then pull that chair back. Sit next to the ones you love. Watch one run away. And yet recognize that even on that night, that he was to be betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Take." And in like fashion, he took the cup. And after giving thanks and praise, he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you. As often as you eat this bread and drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of our Lord and Savior." So beautiful